everyone, and welcome along to this. This is our little tutorial session for this week's song. Shouldn't take long. There's really not much you need to know about this particular song. It's called A Picture of You, and it was a hit in 1962 for Joe Brown and the Brothers with two V's. Tell you a little bit about that. The Brothers started off as the Spacemen Skiffle Group back in about 1957. And then a year or so later, they recruited a young lead guitarist by the name of Joe Brown and sort of incorporated him into the Spacemen Skiffle Group. And they went around the country touring under the auspices of the promoter Jack Good as the kind of house band for these package tours that he put together, and some of them, something very similar, still operates to this day. But singers, you may well remember the wonderful name Vince Eager was one of their featured singers, as was Marty Wilde, before he was considered big enough to have his own group, the Wildcats, and a young solo singer named Jerry Dorsey, who later went on to become Engelbert Humperdinck, of course. And the Spacemen Skiffle Group, as they were known, had about five-piece band they were, and their bass player was a man named Peter Oakman, and one of the rhythm guitarists was called John Beveridge, and they were songwriters as well. And in about 1962, they wrote a song called A Picture of You. Now, that was going to go on the B-side of a 45 RPM single. The A-side was called A Layabout's Lament, and it was released on Pi Records, say, in 62. You may remember A Layabout's Lament. The refrain of it went, "Our local labour exchange has gone to rack and ruin, so I reckon I'll have to find myself a job." Recorded by Joe Brown and the Brothers, Picture of You was the B-side. But it quickly became obvious that the Picture of You was the more popular song, and it assumed the A-side and reached number two in the charts in 1962. It's a pretty little song. Well, it's not difficult, but it's got one or two little interesting points to it. The first of which is the introduction. Now, the song is in the key of G, but the introduction actually starts on the key of F and works its way up to G. Okay, now that's a problem, because if you try and play your normal F with your first and second fingers, like that, then your fingers are in the wrong place to be where they need to be next. So it's all about anticipation, this. So if you play your F chord using those two fingers, the second and third finger, middle and ring, like so, that leaves your index finger free, because you're going to need it to bar across the first and then after that the second fret. So we've got the, I'll just play the intro through, so just to remind you of how it sounds. It goes. Right. So we start on the F with those two fingers, and then we just remove the middle finger to get the, to just get that little Then we need to slide the two fingers on the fretboard up to the next fret and drop the index finger down as a bar on the first fret, which gives us an F sharp chord, and then slide up again, which gives us the G chord. Okay, now there's a G, and if you want, you can slide. So you playing the F chord like that gives you that facility. Let's just do that again. I recommend that if you're playing this song in a group, it's probably better if one single ukulele takes that introduction rather than a group of you trying to do it, because it will probably just sound a bit muddy and unclear if you try to coordinate that. Because the rhythm of this song is quite important. It's got that soft rock, that quick up and down strum in the middle of it, and you might need to experiment with that too. Okay, well, the song itself is simple. It's a nice simple melody and a simple chord accompaniment, as pop songs at that time tended to be. But if we start with that introduction, Pam, Pam will do the rhythm ukulele section as always, and it goes like this: 1, 2, 3, 4. Doing a significant amount of chunking there.
Yes.
Pam, if you'd like to demonstrate what we mean by chunking for those of you who don't know.
Okay, so you play the chord as normal and come down with your nail, the back, you know, on your nail, but you catch the strings with the palm of your hand. So there you get that effect. And it stops them, but it makes a percussive sound.
Yeah, in musical parlance, it's called staccato, which means where you play the chord but cut it off so it doesn't ring out. So it's... I tend to damp a slow, to chunk a slightly different way, because what I do is, if I'm playing bar chords, I just take the pressure off on my fretting hand, and that shortens the sound
but
as well.
But you don't get the percussive effect.
But you don't get quite the percussive effect that chunking does. So that either of those two. And I deliberately use that C chord as 5-4-3-3 rather than that one, because that does tend to ring, because you've got three open strings. So if you fret all four strings, then you've got control over the sound. So in this song, the third line is "but the only sight I want to view." We've got "but the only sight I want to view." You can move that C shape up two frets to play D as 7-6-5-5. And then if you want to slide up through from C through C sharp to D, then all we've got to do is move that whole hand position. So, we get to the end of the verse, in that wonderful picture of you, and that little, that quick up and down is something that is a nice effect, so you might need to work on that, you might not. Second verse, exactly the same as the first, except that it stays on the G. At the end of the line. I still see that picture of you. And we go into the bridge. The bridge is really, really simple. You're just shuffling backwards and forwards between a B minor chord, which is 4-2-2-2, and an A minor chord, 2-2-2-0. So it's just like... what works for me is using index finger to bar the second fret and put my ring finger down on the fourth fret of the G string, and then just slide the whole thing down and use the ring finger to play the A minor rather than the middle finger. Or if you want to bar the B minor chord using your middle finger on the G string, either way, whichever works. Or if you find another way, good for you. So that middle eight goes like, shall we? Yep. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. It was last summer. So it's, we're just shuttling backwards and forwards between a B minor and an A minor till we, for 1 3/4 lines until we get to the end of the second line, and it plays a B minor. Instead of going to A minor, we then go to a D major, because we're resolving to a G. I saw you there on the crest of a hill. Okay, we're going from G to E minor. Now, you remember the little trick for that one is you hold your G chord as normal and drop your ring finger on the fourth fret of the C string. So you're actually, in effect, double fretting the C string. But it gives you, it's easier to go from there to there, just move your little finger, than to go from there to there, complete change of hand position. So we've got the G to an E minor, and then I took a little picture of you. And then we're back into the third verse. And at the end of the third verse, we've got a little instrumental break, which is very simple. See how it works. It's a, you're playing a G and then lifting off the middle finger, so we're getting, we're doing that on a G chord, so we're going F to a D twice. After that, we repeat.
Ah, but how do you play the G added
ninth? Oh, yeah, the G added ninth is you just lift your middle finger off the A string and put it back. Twice through, and then we repeating the last verse, then you were gone like a dream in the night. Got a little coda at the end, which is just rocking between a C chord and a G chord, that wonderful picture of you. There's a little, tiny little interlude where you don't play, but you tap out this rhythm. So that little coda goes, the last verse of the, last line of the verse goes, I only is 7-7-7-10 to finish with, that nice ringing out G at the top there. And that's about it, really.
Don't have to, you can still play it there.
Play it there, you can play your G
anywhere you want.
Anywhere you can find it. Lots of different inversions and positions to play a G chord. And I'm sure you can work those out. And if you can't,
ask us.
You can, if you like, extend that C, D, E. There's another position for the G, for the E chord, actually. F, which is G. Which is 12, 11, 10, 10. No, it isn't. It's 5, 7, 10. It's 10, 9, 8, 8.
I like 7-7-7-10. I can do that one.
No. I was right, first time. 12-11-10-10. G.
Right.
I'm confusing myself. Okay, I said it was going to be a short one today, and so it has proved. If you've got any problems with it, ask away. Of course, if you want the song sheet, then it is available to email out as soon as our email starts working again.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll have a play along version of this, complete with Graham, I hope, at the weekend. And then we're doing another comic song. It's coming Friday, our Friday Frolics. So that's something else to look out for. And so we're going to keep doing this as long as we need to. So I hope it entertains you for a moment. Okay?
Yep.
That's about it. About all from us for today. So we'll leave you in peace and let you get on with doing something interesting. So until we meet again, it's goodbye from Pam.
Bye.
Bye from me, and stay safe. Take care of yourselves and look after each other. Bye-bye for now.